Welcome, 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 everybody. I am here with a special guest to our new interview series. I am with the wonderful, grinding, adventurous Wes Averhart, man. Round of applause for Wes Averhart, man. I mean, I got so many verbs and adjectives. I mean, just your story alone, man. You know, we have had conversations, and your story alone, man, it's overwhelming sometimes to think about where you've come from and what you've done, and just knowing that a lot of people honestly wouldn't be able to withstand what you have, and then, you know, withstand the length of time and pressure that you've had on your shoulders, man. And a lot of people, you know, crumble under those circumstances. So I know the audience is not yet familiar, but they will quickly be, you know, brought abreast to what it is that Wes Averhart is about. So if you don't mind starting out, let's talk about the origin of Wes Averhart, you know, the beginning, the start.
Okay. I grew up in Chicago, state of Illinois. You know, I grew up on the west side. I went from the west side to the south side. And, you know, in that city, violence is prevalent in every community. Right. And, you know, I grew up in a household with a single parent at the age of six, I believe. You know, my mother and father separated. And that left me at a huge disadvantage, you know, because growing up as a young boy, you know, when you fall or things like that, you know, there is nobody there now to nurture those wounds. So, you know, I had to deal with those things on my own, you know, because my father, you know, he was one of the strong guys, you know, ex-military, and just instilled a lot of courage in me. So, and as I got older, you know, in my teenage years, you know, he wasn't present a lot. You know, he was present and he wasn't present. But he definitely gave me a lot of inspiration and motivation throughout the years. But I grew up with a lot of insecurities, and that stems from me being a bedwetter, being called names at school, and, you know, I had to deal with that. I developed low self-esteem, a lot of insecurities, and I didn't know how to deal with them. So I turned to anger, aggression, and violence. So by the time I was 13 years old, I had been suspended from elementary school at least 5 times.
Wow.
For me being able to not deal with those emotions. Mm-hmm. You know, and I later turned to the gangs. You know, when you grew up with a lack of understanding and not able to deal with those emotions, you turn to like-minded individuals, people with, you know what I mean, insecurities like yourself. So
right.
I turned to the streets, and the streets became, you know, my savior. Mm-hmm. You know, if they was robbing, I was robbing. If they were stealing, I was stealing. If they was beating somebody up, I was beating somebody up. You know, I just tried to live up to, you know, that street status, that representation.
Right.
And that led me down a path of destruction. You know, I continuously, repeatedly, you know, I took on new adventures within the game that constantly and repeatedly led me in bad situations.
Right. And so with all those situations, you know, what happened over and over again, as far as, like you said, just being within the gangs and looking for that out, that ultimately led to what for you?
Well, when I joined the gang, you know, I became obsessed with the gang lifestyle, from wearing the clothes, the colors, the representation, going to parties, just being heavily involved and associated with that life. And I became an obsession of mine, you know. In CGA, we taught that that's OCP, obsession, compulsive aggression. So after I became obsessed with that lifestyle, I felt compelled to just do more and more, because I began to identify with that as being loved,
right.
You know, doing more and more, like, oh yeah, don't worry about it. I'll fight him. Oh, don't worry about it. You know, I take it from him. Oh, don't worry about it. We're getting back, you know, things like that. And, it just progressed to the point where, you know, I took a man's life in 2003, August 17th, You know, the gang lifestyle definitely dictated, you know, my lifestyle back then.
Wow. And after that happened, of course, you know, that led to your incarceration from what I want to say, what was it, probably 2004, after going through all the series of trials and, you know, the judiciary system and whatnot.
Absolutely. I believe it was March 12th. I committed the act of murder in August 17, 2003. And I went on a run for approximately, I believe it was 6 or 7 months. I was apprehended March 12th, 2004. And they flew me back to California because I was in Chicago, avoiding, you know, authorities.
Right.
And when I got arrested, they flew me out here, I believe it was March 25th. Then I began the process of being incarcerated in California. And I was served 41 months in the county jail awaiting my sentence. And they sentenced me to 31 years in the California state prison system.
Wow. And 31 years, I understand that on the other side, man, I hope I'm not offending you by saying this. I understand that on the other side, we can never compare the years, and that's not what I'm trying to do. But just hearing that, you know what I mean? And you understood because you seem like an individual who knew what he had done. So when you heard that, your thoughts at that point was it like, I made my bed, it's time to lie in it? Or was it like, did you immediately realize where things went wrong?
I didn't immediately realize it because I grew up impulsive. So that's the lack of understanding of your action. So, you know, I just did what I did because, you know, I was just running on adrenaline. You know, my ideas, I never took that there would be consequences for the actions because I grew up with underdeveloped sense of responsibility. You know, so that just drove my impulses. If something was going on, I felt the coping skill I had at the time was just to use anger, aggression, and violence. So it took me a while to acknowledge it. When they put them handcuffs on March 12, 2004, I definitely realized that, you know, I was going away for a long time, you know, and I would be away from my family. And but at the time, you know, I was still thinking I was right. That's the thing. That gang mentality, it had me thinking I was right. Like, yeah, if you did that, you put in some work, you know, that was my mentality at that particular time in my life.
Wow. And you know what? That's what I was meaning. You know, when I asked that last question, that's what I was getting at. If you recognized it immediately or if it was one of those things that, you know, you're like, man, I screwed this up, or, you know, like, damn, I see where I went wrong. You know, that I should have never went this way. And that's what led to this and this and that. But that happened for you over time. And from that time, March 12th?
No, August.
2000?
March 12th, I got arrested. 2004.
They locked up March 12th, right? 2004?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so at that point in time, so from that time until what time were you at the point where you're at now, where you're on the brink of once again having freedom? That in between that gap, that's how many years incarcerated has total have you done?
I did 16 years and almost 11 months in the California prison system. You could basically round that off to 17 years of incarceration.
Right. Damn. 17 years, man. That's a lot of time. And let's talk about, because this is, I want people to understand how positive this is. Like, you know, I definitely understand that it started out, you know, with a negative connotation to it, just because we need to lead up to, you know, what's going on now, because this interview is by no way for the fact that, you know, a life was taken. It's more so about the correcting of that. It's more so about the building and what you're doing to give back, to make amends for that. So I just want to go into the accomplishments, man, because your story is so amazing to me. And that's one reason why I couldn't wait to do this with you, because what you've accomplished over those 17 years, in my opinion, is, man, you've accomplished more than some people accomplished in a lifetime in those 17 years. And even just on the tip of knowledge, you know what I mean? So let's talk about some of the things that you've established since you've been incarcerated.
Okay, well, my transition actually started back in 2013. I was placed in the kitchen. And I didn't like that atmosphere at that particular time. So I asked to get a new job, and they put me auto mechanics. I found, you know, my father grew up in mechanics. Mm-hmm. So I was like, we learn about cars. So I became a certified automotive technician within 6 months and got certified. You know, that began, you know, I mean, a small turnaround for me, but I still was criminal minded. I still hadn't addressed those issues. And by 2015, you know, I had a conversation with my pops, a few other individuals. He was like, do what you got to do. Be what you got to be. You know what I mean? Wake up, you know, be whatever, become whatever you got to become in prison to come home. And I was like, let me go ahead and try college. Let me try college. Mm-hmm. And college turned out to be one of the most significant blessings in my life. You know, I went to school. Well, when I first entered prison, like, my reading wasn't that good. My writing wasn't that good. If you see a letter that I wrote 15 years ago, you probably laugh and say, what third grader wrote this? Now I got to the point where I could articulate myself so well, whether on paper or in person, that it still amazes me. All right. So education was the key to my turnaround because I was able to gain a lot of understanding about life in general. And I seen a lot of guys putting themselves in position to go home. I was like, I want to go home. I want to do that. Guys petitioning to the governor to commute their sentences. And I wanted to put myself one day in that situation because I was looking at coming home 2030, 2031, because I hadn't made that turnaround. And it was difficult for me because the temptation was so huge.
Right.
You know, to get a cell phone or to sell something for somebody and make some quick money, quick cash, just to alleviate some of the stress, the stressors of allowing my family to just send me money or send me clothes or shoes, because prison doesn't provide for a lot. So when I entered college in 2015, it turned out to be a blessing. You know, I graduated college. I received my first degree in 2017, second degree in 2018, and two more degrees in 2019. So I have four associate degrees. Wow. From Palo Verde's College.
And those degrees
are? And, math and science, arts and humanities, social and behavior science, and business and technology.
Nice, nice. That's a beautiful thing, man.
I also have my specialist in drug addiction, specialist one.
Wow.
I'm in pursuit to get two and completely get certified so I continue to give back.
Mm. And that's why I said, man, like, you've done so much in college, man, that I see people, you know, in 15, 20 years of education, man, having accomplished. So that just goes to show your drive. And one of the biggest things that I really appreciate, man, because we are so disadvantaged when it comes to the prison system and just the court systems and just the makeup of the system itself. So to see that a lot of times we don't get a chance at redemption, or we don't get a chance at, you know, a second chance, because it's like, hey, 1, 2, 3, you're out, you know, or sometimes it's 1, you're out. You know what I mean? I know partners that I have that have been locked up for marijuana use and was given a sentence as somebody who might have committed murder, you know, or worse. And now
absolutely
marijuana is almost legal everywhere. You know what I mean? So
yeah,
basically, you know, next question I want to ask you is, I want to start to get into coping mechanisms, because I, you know, I've had a couple conversations with you, man, and it's amazing when you start to talk about the coping mechanisms. And I want to talk about some of those that you had, which would probably be advice to others, because there are a lot of people that, let's be honest, have been locked up and are free, but still feel locked up because they lack the basic coping mechanisms to just cope with everyday life. You know what I mean? I know some people that don't have a lot of problems, but find it hard to cope. So I just want to get into that a little bit, a couple of your coping mechanisms and what helped you through.
Absolutely. Well, first, prayer, man. Prayer. Put God first. Mm. God has always come first in my life. You know, I put him first. I pray before I go to sleep at night. I pray in the morning. You know, I pray for, you know, the wayward, the sick. You know, I pray for, you know what I mean, those that still, you know, may hold me in a low regard, because I'm a positive person now. And, you know, the stagnation stems from individuals failing to address their issues. So you have to go in order to get out. If you don't address what you're dealing with internally, it's going to be a repeated cycle for you. You know, so you have to prepare for your freedom. When I was walking around and going to classes in prison, individuals were like, oh yeah, you preparing for board. No, I'm not preparing for board. I'm preparing for my freedom for the rest of my life. It's not a preparation for board. It's a preparation for the rest of your life. And some of the coping skills I use today, it's called a STAR. I stop. First, I stop. And I analyze my thoughts. Why am I feeling this way? You know what I mean? Then I'm thinking. I'm thinking, like, what's the best move right now? And I'm assessing that. And then I respond. It's called STAR. You have to stop, think, assess your thoughts for the best outcome, and then respond in situations. I address my anger now in the moment, because I know if I allow it to ruminate, things may potentially escalate somewhere down the line, or I may take it out on somebody who doesn't deserve being disrespected or verbally assaulted.
Right.
You know, and one of the key components I utilize daily is applying emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is what will allow world peace. Emotional intelligence, if it's applied by every person on this earth, it will allow for world peace. First of all, you have self-awareness. Self-awareness is understanding your emotions and how you feel in the moment and being able to address them respectfully and righteously according to your spiritual principles in which you choose to live by. Secondly, it's self-motivation. You have to learn to motivate yourself to do better, want better. Thirdly, self-management. Manage your life. Don't allow your life to manage you. You have to manage every aspect of your life. When I was in that cell, I micromanaged every aspect of my life down to the dime. There were months where I had $6 to spend. Oh, $6? I'm going to buy 8 soups, a couple bars of soap, and whatever else I feel I need as a necessity. Fourthly, you have social wellness. That means empathy. Having concern for other people. That's the problem today that we face. People don't have enough concern for other people. That's why you have people living on the streets, committing crimes. There's not enough jobs because won't nobody give them a job due to them being formerly incarcerated or they don't like the way they look. And lastly, it's interpersonal relationships and communication. Mm-hmm. Every relationship that you have in your life is going to be different. The relationship that you have with your brother is going to be different from the relationship you have with your sister. That relationship is going to be different from the relationship you have with your mother. That relationship is going to be different from the one you have with your father and your friends and people you choose to associate. You know, once you apply all 5 components, you have emotional intelligence and you can execute empathy every day of your life. Every day of your life. You just have to stop and process those thoughts in order to move forward. Because if you don't stop and process those thoughts, you're going to respond impulsively and you're going to hurt somebody or somebody going to hurt you and you're going to find yourself in a bad situation like I did.
100%, man. I couldn't agree with you more, man. Those are great, great principles, man. Great principles to live by. But the most important thing that I took out of that, and tell me if I'm wrong, is to stop and think. Because it's hard to get through any of those if you don't really take that second to think. And I think we've all been in that situation at one point. I've been a hothead, you know, at some point. So I get that, you know what I mean? And that's amazing, you know what I mean? And I want people to really, really take that in, man, that star concept and everything behind it. And so with that being said, let's get into some of the programs, man, that you have in the work. As far as in your head, you have some in your head and you have some that actually have hit the ground and actually have legs and have a foundation, you know? So I just think needs to be picked up a little bit more, you know, to keep it moving. But hey, let's talk about some of the programs that you've endorsed and creating.
Okay, well, outside of emotional intelligence, you have CGA, which is Criminal Gang Anonymous. It's like something that us is, I'm an ex-felon. You know, I mean, ex-convict, wherever they may be, you know, I'm still on parole. But CGA is something inmates started in prison to help other inmates to address their issues. Because if you understand CGA, it's a 12-step program. And once you go through the process of understanding and being lucid to what's actually going on, okay, lucid and understanding are the same 2 words. You know, they're synonymous with each other. And once you begin to understand why you commit a lot of the crimes you do, you begin the process of doing things different with coping skills. Right. With coping skills. If you don't have coping skills, there's no way that you could go to a place and sit there for 10 years and not take on anything that's encouraging you to do something productive and positive with your life and say, oh yeah, I'm ready to go home, I'm free. No, you have to begin the process of preparing for your freedom. If you don't begin the process of preparing for your freedom, this door is open for you. Like my old cell, it's open for somebody right now.
Right.
There's a bed waiting for somebody right now. Mm-hmm. You know, so you have to acknowledge, you know, where you are in life. Like, I'm not where I want to be in life, but I know one day, you know, through proper preparation, that I'm going to be where I need to be, you know, in 5 years, 10 years, maybe next year.
Right.
Because I'm constantly planning. My thoughts are constantly evolving, you know, so I'm trying to take, you know, what I have now and give it back. But I also want to, maintain who I am as a person. Right. You know, be authentic, be genuine, you know, in groups like CGA, Criminal Gang Anonymous, that allowed me to do that. And I learned in CGA that a reason why we live such disruptive lifestyles is we give certain situations and names their own definition. It's like antisocial. You ask anybody, you walk up to anybody on the street right now, ask them what antisocial means. You know what they're going to say? Oh, a person that don't talk to nobody. Antisocial is not a person that don't talk to nobody. That's a person that wants to live a disruptive life. That's a person who wants to be anti-society. You don't agree what's going on with the law, so you want to be anti-society.
Right.
That's what it is. It's not what you think it is. We give a lot of words definitions. You solid. You're a real one. What does that mean? Solid means form, the form of something. You're a real one. Oh, this is real. This is authentic. And they have a negative connotation attached to them in that lifestyle, when you live in that lifestyle, because you fail to address that those are negative words. Those are destructive words. Mm. You know, so first you have to start applying words how they're supposed to be utilized in the world today. If you don't do that, it's definitely a problem. Second group that I like to mention, third group I like to mention is AVP, Alternative to Violence. It's called the Transforming Powers. If you're in a situation with somebody and in order to defuse the situation, you just apologize. Man, I'm sorry you feel that way. That was definitely my fault. Or you just apply some moral standards.
Right.
You know, and that's basically learning how to build communities based on trust, honesty, and care. Or if you're wrong, promptly admit that you're wrong.
Right.
You know, or use surprise and humor. You know, those are just coping skills that you can utilize just to like diffuse a situation versus allowing it to escalate. Because it's ways that you could diffuse a situation. You don't have to have that intense conversation with the person that's being irate with you. You can be like, okay, I understand. See, once you turn on that switch and you intensify the conversation, then that's gonna lead to something destructive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so AVP utilizing the transforming powers have definitely been hugely in my life, and that's also a 12-step program. And there's also a program called ACP, Addiction Counseling Program. I was a drug addiction counselor in prison. And addiction doesn't just consist of people suffering from drugs or alcohol. It consists also of lifestyle. You can become accustomed to living a certain way and not realize that you're in a full-blown addiction.
Right.
And we fail all the time by failing to address those issues too. See, and that's another reason why I want to start my own rehabilitation program. Drug addicts, when they come in, or people who use drugs when they come in. There's no way you could just graduate the program, spend 90 days in the program and say, oh yeah, I graduated. No, you have to write a relapse prevention plan and start using some of those coping skills that you learn within the system. If you don't utilize those, where are they gonna go?
Right, which is kind of like—
you're not ready.
Right, like a business plan. If you want to start a business, you need a business plan. You know, just like life.
Absolutely.
You know, where you want to be in life, you need goals. So I get that. And that makes sense.
Absolutely.
You know, to have a foundation. And a couple of these, if I'm not mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong, has been already picked up by some of the local governments, right? And are actually in play.
Rehabilitation has been picked up nationally. Mm-hmm. You know, they understand now that, you know, they was wrong for sending people who suffer from addictions to prison. We need to put them in programs. But that information was available 50 years ago.
Right.
It's not a surprise. You had this information, but they chose to like incarcerate them to make money. Like when I was incarcerated, you know how much money they got off me every year? $80,000.
Wow.
They was paying $80,000. Did I deserve to be incarcerated? Absolutely. But they would pay $80,000 just to house me.
Hmm.
That's wow. College tuition over and over again.
Yeah, that's a fact. That's a fact. Yeah, that's
absolutely.
Man, that's amazing. That's amazing. But, those numbers. Yeah, just thinking about that, man, and the numbers. And I mean, not to dive too far into that, and you know, but to give people the raw, you know, the rawness and the realness of what we're talking about here and what you've been through. If you don't mind, let's dive into the prison system a little bit. Like, you know, just the main part about it. And I know, you know, we see movies and, you know, things like that. And, you know, you get a picture of or an idea of what it's supposed to be like in prison or what you think. But coming from somebody who spent, you know, a majority or a good chunk of their adult life in prison, it, the main part I want to focus on is, you know, I, of course, I know it was rough, and I know there was probably times that you have probably had to fear for your life or make decisions to get out of a situation that might have cost you your life. Am I correct on that?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, in prison, it's definitely a very, very violent place. You know, you have to acknowledge that. Every time you leave your cell, which is your, when you're in your cell, that's your comfortability. Kick back, that's your sanctuary. But when you step out of that cell and that door closes, your life is absolutely on the line. You don't know who's talking behind your back. You don't know if it's a riot going to happen. You may be the one getting stabbed. And I've been in multiple riots where individuals have got stabbed and murdered. Mm-hmm. And I've seen multiple individuals get murdered on the yard. You know, I just chose, you know, to be so much, I chose a path which led me to be more so to myself. Even though I did engage, I chose to be to myself because I didn't want to never put myself in a situation where I'm dealing with a group of individuals and they dealing with a group of individuals who dislike them. Right. So, you know, I pretty much ran by myself in prison. You know, I found it, you know, I felt if I could stand on my own, you know, then this is where I need to be, you know, and I'm comfortable doing this. You know, there was multiple times where individuals that asked me, oh yeah, you with this, you with that. No, I'm absolutely not with that. You know, you keep that over there. I'm not going to take on the same enemies that you have and allow them to become my enemies when I don't know them at all.
Right. And that's a big thing because we've always been told or we've always heard, for those of us who have never seen the prison system or never had to, we've always been told that being by yourself is dangerous. You know, and I know that in Chicago, you know, it's like when you walk in there, I know a lot of those elements are who you're running with. It's either you going this way or you going that way. You know, and so a lot of people say being by yourself is dangerous, and you know, and you survive that. So man, that's saying something, you know, to take that stand.
Well, absolutely. Well, the California prison system actually, like, I'm not gonna say that they allow it, but they pretty much know what's going on. When you first come in, whether it be the county jail or the prison, you know, in many cases they ask you who you run with and who you sell up with. If this is supposed to be a place, right, where you're supposed to rehabilitate me and I'm supposed to gain a level of understanding and I'm supposed to go to these groups, I'm supposed to live a more righteous life, right? Why are you asking me who I am and who I run with? This is supposed to be a place where none of this is supposed to be going on. You putting me in a different societal place that's still executing anti-societal beliefs. Mm. And that's exactly what it is.
Wow.
You know, I just chose a different route. I said, you know, once I began the process of educating myself and going to groups, I seen guys going on. I said, okay, I'm going to get involved in these groups. And it got to the point where I was able to give back. I was teaching groups the last 4 or 5 years in prison. Mm. You know, groups like emotional intelligence, CGA, criminal, AVP, you know, I wanted to give back. You know, guys felt, you know, that my story to them would be impactful and the coping skills that I utilized, I wanted to give them to them. Right. Like, you don't have to say that. You don't have to do that. You don't even have to entertain that. Sometimes it's best just to turn around and walk away.
100%. 100%. And it's good to learn that early.
It's not just pride. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Pride will get you killed. Yeah. Pride in prison will get you killed. Being angered and aggressive and violent will get you killed in prison. You have to humble yourself when you come to prison initially and find out and assess how things work in prison before you immediately involve yourself into something. Every prison yard I ever got to, I gave myself 90 days to observe what was going on in these yards so I could see who was with who and who I don't need to be associating with.
Right.
Well, that gave me a better understanding of how my time was going to be at this specific prison.
Hey, which ties back into just talking about your emotional intelligence. You know what I mean? Thinking about
absolutely
when that kicked in, let's just say immediately you didn't have that emotional intelligence when you walked in there. You know what I mean? You
absolutely.
You know, so it took time for you to get that. So had you made the wrong moves based off not having that emotional intelligence, it could have cost you your life.
Absolutely. What could cost you your life in prison, man, is not having remorse for what you've done. Mm. Yeah. When you walk around unremorseful and a lack of empathy for other people, that can definitely cost you your life as well. I had to come to terms with what I had done was bad. was destructive, you know, and I was preparing myself never to put myself in a situation again while I was in prison. You know, that's how I developed remorse and praying and staying to myself and associate with individuals who was like-minded, preparing themselves to go home. You know, individuals like Dashi O'Keefe, Mark Taylor, Dominique Tanks, Marcus Marsh, you know, them guys helped me. Cedric Pierce, these guys helped me come home. We shared in something that was like unique. Mm. You know, being in that environment, you know, it may be, you know, you may hear dudes, oh yeah, dude says, I don't care about what dude said, I'm going to group.
Right.
What he gonna do in 10 years when he go to board? Get right. Denied? No, and I don't want nobody to get denied when they go to board. But you cannot talk about what I'm doing and you're preparing yourself for your freedom.
Right.
That's one of the biggest things that people deal with today in prison. Mm-hmm. So like, oh yeah, he going to group. Oh, that's some sucker shit. No. There's nothing sucker about wanting to achieve your freedom, wanting to gain your freedom, have your freedom again. You know what I enjoy most when I get up every day? I put on clothes.
Yeah.
I put on real clothes every day. This is amazing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This is amazing. Put on new clothes every day. I'll be amazed, man. I'm like, oh yeah, let me get them shoes. Let me get them pants. You know, I'll be amazed, man. Shocked. Because the world has changed. I was gone 17 years, man, and the world has drastically changed.
Yeah.
100%. You know, my first week out of prison, I locked myself out of my own cell phone.
Wow.
I had to get a brand new one.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Yeah, man. So yeah, man, you know, you gotta pay attention, man. Technology is advanced.
Yeah.
You know, so you have to prepare yourself for the times, man.
Yeah, the world is moving fast.
It's transitioned out here.
It really is. I'm so glad, man. This story, like, be completely honest, like, it makes me happy to talk to you, man, because I know so many people will benefit from a lot of the things that we're talking about. And, you know, a lot of times this stuff is taboo. And like you said, just knowing, you know what I mean? Knowing your role and understanding, having that emotional intelligence, you know, when it comes to just making everyday decisions, you know what I mean? That will change you. Like you said, this being... not worrying about what people think and not worry about what the outside is thinking. Like you said, with people saying, oh, that's some sucker shit, you go in the group, not understanding your goal. But we're always going to have those people like that. And I really think this message resonates with teenagers and those who really don't know. I have a son that's going into his senior year in high school, still haven't completely figured out what it is that he wants to do, but working on it. But knowing that, like you said, like, there's always going to be the outside noise saying, ah, you doing that, that's some sucker shit. Oh, you doing that, that's this, you know, that's going to have their opinion on it. But just knowing and having that emotional intelligence to know that what you think don't matter. I got to live this life.
Absolutely.
I think a lot of bridges are going to be built, you know, based off of our conversations and, you know, just for the people out there, man, this will definitely not be the last time. Wes is a full-time family member of the podcast and what we're doing. Like, you will definitely see my brother popping in quite often, you know? So I want to work with you, to be honest. I mean, I know we haven't talked about this behind the scenes, but once we're off camera, I do want to speak with you a little more about this to set up something where maybe once a week, we can do a group where, you know, we can reach out to some of the teens and some of the older individuals, man, and maybe hold, let's say, you know, a 5 to 10 member class a week, you know, just maybe 30 minutes, just, you know, to give people better coping skills. What do you think about that, man?
And we could definitely do that, man, because I personally done the work and I realized that I got all my insecurities from the age to 8 to 13. Every last one of them, from low self-esteem, low self-worth, you know, feeling insecure, all of them develop from age 8 to 13. And if we can give the kids or, you know, teenagers some coping skills to deal with some of those insecurities, feeling inadequate, that would definitely help them in their life. That would definitely be beneficial to their lives.
100%.
You know, you got thousands or probably millions of kids out there today who are dealing with certain emotions that they don't understand. See, we just say the word emotion, but what emotion are you dealing with? Right. Oh, she just emotional. Oh, he just emotional. No, how are they feeling? You have to identify how you feel in order to move forward. If you're not identifying how you feel, how you gonna move forward? Facts. There's no progression if you don't identify the problem.
Facts.
Period.
100%. And while we're on
I would definitely be willing to do that.
That's gonna be a beautiful thing, man. I definitely want to talk to you more about that. Just, you know, as we continue to build, you know, this relationship and helping others, man, and the mission that I think we both are on. But we talked about the prison system a little bit. There's something that I want to talk about, maybe a little off record, but
okay.
I'm sorry, not off record, but off the cuff, I meant that, you know, you're probably not expecting, but with just the year that we've had, this last year and a half, you know, of just craziness, you know, COVID, and there was a lot of things that went on in the prison systems that weren't really talked about. You know, we saw some videos and it, you know, especially at the beginning of COVID and when all this stuff started, and you heard stories and you saw some individuals who had cell phones and were able to tell their story and reach out and just saying that they've been treated like animals. And, you know, did you see any of that? Were you involved in any of the mistreatment?
I was a part of it. I was treated like the animal. Okay. I got diagnosed with COVID December 22nd, 2020. And I came out my cell today on the 23rd to use the phone. And they said, y'all don't got no phone calls. So I couldn't call my people to notify them to tell them that I'm sick and potentially die. I wouldn't ever use the phone for 5 days. And I was told by the floor officer at that particular time that it was a sergeant who said that we couldn't use the phones. So, and what they did to us, they locked us in our cells. Initially, they locked us in our cells when we had COVID. They had a nurse come through in the morning, check our temperature, check our oxygen in the morning, and then check it again in the evening. There was no vitamin C. There was no orange juice. There was nothing to build our immune system. That's why so many people died in the prison system. There was nothing given to us to keep to help our immune system build and to keep us healthy. Wow. I literally watched my cellie almost die. My cellmate almost died in his cell. I literally watched this man. He'd been incarcerated 35 years. Every day he used to tell the nurse, like, yeah, she asked, is anything wrong? He said, just my breathing. Wow. Now, by the seventh day, he told her that my breathing was bad. She said, we're gonna get you out of here. That the CO came through to do like the 11 o'clock count. And he said, hey, man, they supposed to be taking me out. He said, well, why they supposed to be taking you out? He said, because I'm having difficulty breathing. The CO had the nerve to tell him, you talking to me right now? You sound like you breathe. So Marcelli just turned around and started kicking the door.
Wow.
Kicking the door. This man got to kick the door to get out the cell.
To get out.
Wow. Now you tell me that ain't inhumane.
Yeah.
If I need to go to the doctor, if I'm on the street and I need to go to the emergency room, I can go. You're in prison and you tell me you can't breathe, you need to go to the emergency room. That man went out to the emergency room and was gone almost 9 days.
Wow.
But, you know, he's walking around breathing now. He's healthy now. I talk, you know, he says he's doing fine, which is a blessing. Because I literally watched this man, like, barely move around the cell. Every step he took, he was out of oxygen.
Thankfully.
People dying from COVID-19. You got everybody locked in their cells. For 21 days, we was in our cells. 21 days. Wow. Then they allowed us to use the phones here and there. But, you know, the phone situation, I figure that phone situation needs to change, too. 15 minutes to talk to your loved ones, I think it needs to be a half an hour. Mm-hmm. There's only so much you can say in 15 minutes, especially when you're dealing with COs who haven't failed to address their own personal insecurities and their emotions, telling you, it took you 2 minutes to walk to the phone. It took you 2 minutes to dial. You only got 11 minutes left.
Wow.
And you got 15 minutes in those totality for the phone call. So it's blatantly disrespectful.
Yes.
You know, I done been in situations where, you know, I done received the 115, which is disciplinary infraction in prison, when I was completely in the right and was found guilty based on yard schematics.
Right.
Or the say-so of a CO. When the seeing hearing officer is supposed to be completely non-biased. That's right. When you go in front of a judge and two people say something and they hear the information. When we go up in there, the seeing hearing officer clearly states, my staff said you did this and I believe my staff. That's not your position.
Right.
That's not your role to say you believe your staff. Go off the evidence. They do not go off the evidence. People are constantly getting time taken away from them, not by a judge, but by CDC. If you get a write-up, they take it 90 days from you. They take it 90 days of canteen. You know what I mean? And you can't go outside or you can't use the phone. Now you tell me that ain't inhumane to tell a person who's incarcerated, potentially serving a life sentence, that he can't get a package, he can't go to canteen, he can't go outside, and he can't use the phone.
Wow.
What, you gonna leave him in the cell? And that's what they do. They call, the cell is called CTQ, confined to quarters.
Wow. It's,
you know, so I definitely believe the system needs to change.
Yeah. And I'm
retraining or something.
I'm happy that you've been digging deep, man, and you got your toes on the ground, man. Like you making moves on that and pushing towards different legislation and the things that you're doing, man. I 100% appreciate it, man. Like I appreciate your whole story and I can't wait to dig more, you know. But let me ask you something before we get out of here. I want to turn it to a happy note, man, because this is something that probably goes unnoticed. But let me ask you about something that you found, you know, during, you know, some of the hardest times of your life. And this is something, of course, I can relate to. But let me ask you about marriage. You know, how do you feel about marriage? I think you found something there, if I'm not mistaken. I see the ring.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That thing don't ever come off this finger. You know what I mean? I don't dislodge it for nothing.
I get it.
You know, I believe it's between a man, it's between husband and wife, you know. But I definitely found my wife while I was incarcerated. You know, I reached out to her in 2016 and she was receptive. And we had a conversation over time and, you know, we grew to love each other. You know what I mean? She's been a godsend in my life. You know, she absolutely been a godsend. You know, she definitely is one of the blessings, you know what I mean, God sent me. You know, when I'm wrong, she let me know when I'm wrong. You know, and a lot of people in my past, they never told me that I was wrong. Or you're doing something wrong or you're not doing something right. And she's definitely been, you know what I mean, a great helper in that aspect of my life. You know what I mean? And we definitely have built something real strong. You know, she just went back home on the 9th. She was out here for a whole week.
Nice, man. Nice.
You know, she has drive, motivation, spiritual. You know, she's a strong believer in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, so a brother couldn't ask for anything more.
Yeah, that's a beautiful thing. And I wanted to touch on that because that's the happier part. You know, of course, we talked about the grind. We talked about everything that, you know, went on in the prison system, the things that you're building. But guess what? You got somebody building with you. You know what I mean? And I think that's...
Absolutely.
I didn't want that part to go unnoticed. I seen the ring. I said, oh, yeah, I want to talk about that. You know, I want to talk about that. We, you know, as Black brothers, we don't see a lot of marriage talk, you know. So whenever I get a chance to really chop it up, you know, it's always good to find out what marriage means to another brother, you know. And I know we all, overall, it's the same, you know. But, I mean, everybody has their thing, you know. Everybody has that void that needed to be filled, you know what I mean, no matter what it is.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I'm glad that
marriage has its ups and downs, but at the end of the day, right? You got to acknowledge what brought you together in the first place. You know what I mean? Right. Like, we together for a reason. And what's the reason? You know what I mean? And keep readdressing it. And the reason is, I love you and you love me. Let's continue to build. You mad? I'm mad. We're going to get over that because we're addressing the issue. If you don't address the issue within the marriage, how can you move forward? That's with everything in life. You can never get past something unless you have addressed the issue. And when you address the issue, move on. Because if you address the issues within your marriage and you fail to move on, that's definitely going to lead to having internal problems. That's going to be a disruptive relationship.
Right.
You know, that's something out there for the guys and the women. You know, address it and move on. You know, because you'll never want to put your partner in a position where, you know, you're eliminating that level of comfortability, something that you have joy in or just that feeling of joy, you know?
Right. 100%, man. Hey, I can't wait, Wes, till we can sit down, you know what I mean, and just say, hey, have a glass of ice water or iced tea, whatever it is, man, you know, and that's coming real soon, you know what I mean? I can't wait. Like, we've built a relationship here over the last couple months, and, you know, that's what it wasn't all about this interview. Like, I just thought that it would be highly intriguing and highly informational because, like I said, your story is ageless. And you know what I mean? It doesn't have an age bracket. You know what I mean? I think the information that you have and that you're out here working towards and in the programs that you're producing can help anybody from teen to adult. There's no age on it, you know? And I told you that before, and I don't know if you know what I meant by it. I'm sure you did, but just, you know, in case you didn't, I mean, I think this is global, you know what I mean? Information. I think these are global, just tactics that can be used, a global foundation that can be instilled in the individuals that they could use every single day, you know, because I know after talking to you, I use some of them, you know what I mean? Just a little more, some that I was probably already using, but didn't really know. And I'm like, oh, okay. I have been kind of doing that, but let me just stay on the path and straighten it up, man. So is there any message that you have, man? Cause I know, honestly, I do want to, I'm not going to say want, we are going to definitely build and create classes and whatnot to spread some of this information to teens or whoever is willing, because we got to get out that shell first and foremost of I'm good. You know, we always think we good. You know, any message from you?
Absolutely. Oh yeah, the message to me, man, is if you got a problem, just address it. You know, I don't care if you got to talk to a total stranger. You know, if you're dealing with something emotionally and it affects you, you definitely have to address that problem, because that may explode on someone that you care about. And, you know, they may not know how to take that. They may take that the wrong way and figure like, nah, this definitely ain't me. I can't deal with this. People don't have coping skills. You need to, like, coping skills need to be applied, period. And I got all these tools, and what I have today from groups in prison, from emotional intelligence, AVP, CGA, ACP, on down to, you know, just sitting there, just talking with individuals who are like-minded with powerful minds and want to get out and do something positive and productive with their life, you know? And that's one of the biggest reasons why, you know, it's a revolving door. You get in there, you get comfortable, you conform to what's going on. Oh, that's the homie. Oh yeah, it ain't nothing but a violation. I'll come back and get, no, it ain't about that. What about your life? Cause I know one thing, when you go to prison and you get out, you starting your life all over again. Who wants to be in a position where they have to start their life all over again? It is highly difficult to start your life all over again. I'm 43 years old. I'm finding it challenging, but at the end of the day, I'm motivated. I got a strong support system. I got my mother. I got my brothers. I got my brother. I got my brothers. I got my sisters. You know what I mean? I got family. I got friends. I got a strong support network. I got Tone too. I got you too, Tone.
100%.
You know, I can't appreciate you enough, bro.
100%.
You know,
I'm definitely here. Shout out to your family.
I definitely appreciate this. I definitely appreciate this opportunity, man. But we need to start addressing those emotional issues that we're dealing with eternally, because they're going to explode, because people are allowing things to ruminate over and over and over again. And that's not productive for anybody, the people you're dealing with or yourself.
Right. 100%, man. Let me just say a quick shout out and a round of applause to your family, man, because you said something there that's key. The support system.
Absolutely.
Brother, the support system is huge.
Absolutely, man.
And I don't think you would have made it
absolutely
far without, you know, that support system. And I thank you for allowing me to become part of that, to be completely honest, you know. So
I got one. Absolutely. My biggest supporter, though, man, I want to say, man, you know, it's my wife. I can't thank her enough. That woman waited 5 years for me to get out of prison. You know what I mean? They've been there every step.
And that's,
you know what I mean? Through all the hiccups, she definitely been there.
That's huge, man.
Definitely. You know, so brother can't ask anything more.
Definitely got a, you know, a round of applause for her, man. You know, we definitely don't shy away from, you know, giving women their flowers here, you know, and that's a beautiful thing, man.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm super happy for you, man. Like that background there, man. The sun is shining on you, brother. The sun is definitely shining on you, man. And you got a lot to give, man. And I'm happy that you've allowed me to, to help spread that message, man. And I can't wait to just keep building, man. We got a lot to do, man. We got a lot that we got to link up about and just move on. But honestly, I can't wait to get to Cali to actually really just sit down with you, man, and share some laughs and you know, some ideas so that we could continue to build, man.
Absolutely.
You know, thank you for what you're doing, man. Really, you know, the programs, everything, you know, I can't wait for my daughter to sit down and watch this conversation that we had, because I think it's powerful. I really do, bro.
I appreciate it, man.
Oh, no problem, man.
I appreciate this opportunity.
No, we appreciate you, man. We appreciate you being an open book. Like, without that, we have nothing, you know? So this is amazing content. And I just want to tell everybody out here, thank you for checking out this interview. Please check and keep your eyes open for the wonderful man, the grinder man that he is, Wes Averhart, man. He is on a mission. This man is motivated like no other. You know, so he's getting things done, and I'm glad that I've had a little bit of that rub off on me, because you keep me pushing, man. So I've had some challenging times here the last couple months, man, and you don't know how much of a, you know, just a help and a gem, man. And that you've been a diamond in the rough, my brother, for me even. So don't.
I appreciate it, man. I appreciate it.
Oh yeah, I appreciate you, man. So I wanted to say thank you, man, and I love you, brother. You know, and I'm here. I'm an open book, you know, and I got an open door. You know, my phone always, you know, is on. So let's continue to grind, man, and let's continue to get these people what they want, man. Because there's a lot of people that need things that you are holding on to and don't know it yet. But we're gonna find them. We're gonna get into them.
Absolutely, absolutely, I believe.
Thank you, though, man, from the bottom of my heart, man. Thank you, and let's continue to do this thing.
All right, bro. God bless, man. All right, God bless, bro.
My man. Appreciate you, brother.